We're gonna stay in one spot tonight, where y'all at? How's everybody doing?
Good.
No, you think, Scott? Scott has come out.
Are y'all excited to be here?
Yes!
I know I am. I'm very, very excited to be at Celebrate Freedom on a Friday night.
Right.
Couldn't imagine a better place to be than here celebrating the fact that we're absolutely, permanently, forever free from the bondage of sin.
Yes.
You know, tonight, if you've been following along with me, we've been talking a lot about how who you are and the emphasis being that you're a spirit being and that you're a new creature. And our focus is to be on that new creation and not this flesh that gets us in trouble. And right in the middle of those things, we have a soul, which is a mind, will, and emotion, or a thought process, a personality that we carry a lot of baggage with that has to be renewed so that this new man, this new creation can dominate this jacked up self we are. Because we're all got some issues, right? I don't care how saved you are, you still got some issues. And what we have to do is we have to make up our mind every morning to wake up and to die to ourselves and let God live through us. So what we want to talk about, I want you to understand that we are spirit beings who live in a body that has a soul, the soul being your mind, will, and emotion, your personality. But the emphasis, if you're going to stay free, if you're going to never relapse, you have got to concentrate on the fact that you are a spirit being created in the image and the likeness of God to look like God and to act like God. So you're created just as He was, born a new creation. So the devil wants you to think you're no good. God said you were good. You know, I'm going to go with God.
Yeah. Amen.
Yeah, nobody else believes in me, but God does. Amen. Amen. So go with me to Ephesians 6, and I'm going to read the whole thing about the armor before I get into the rest of the sermon, because I want you to understand. We're talking about God is bigger, but let me tell you something. If and Brother Wayne said it, resist the devil and he'll flee. That's not all of it. It says, submit yourself unto God and resist the devil and he will flee. You know what happens if you resist the devil in the flesh? He will beat the clothes off of you. I got some evidence of that from the disciples that went out and tried to cast out some demons. And apparently there was an issue there somewhere. And they got in a lot of trouble. But what we got to do is we got to concentrate. Concentrate tonight. I want you to get this. It's real important that you get it. Finally, be strong in the Lord in the strength of His might. Whose strength? Be strong where? We can't be strong in ourselves, right? Your will is not enough. Your determination is not enough. You got to lean, trust, and depend on God. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. Let me tell you something. Satan hates two books in the Bible more than any other. Genesis, because it exposes every one of his tricks. And Revelations, because it says how he's going to end up.
Amen.
So if we look at that, Genesis, the third chapter, and then we can flip over there to Matthew, the fourth chapter, and we go to 1 John. We can see that Satan has been using the same tricks over and over and over and over again.
Right.
I've had some attacks this week. And immediately when that person come toward me, God would just drop in my spirit, and he would say, we wrestle not against flesh and blood.
That's right, man.
You know, God will allow attacks to test you, to build your faith. Let me tell you who will attack you sometimes. Christians.
That's right.
Did you know that? But when they attack you, what do? You don't get mad at them. You get mad at Satan.
That's right.
I'm not going to get mad at somebody just because they're a little weak and allow Satan to use them to come at me.
That's good.
We win with love.
Amen. That's right.
For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against cosmic powers over this present darkness, against spiritual forces of evil in heavenly places. Where are the heavenly places? The heavenly places are right here. We are seated. We're in heavenly places. We are created. There is another you that is in heavenly places right now. There's literally angels and demons, even demons in this room right now, listening to this message. You had demons assigned to your family for generation after generation after generation. That's the reason they know your daddy was like this, so they know your mama was like that, so they know how to attack you.
Amen.
Yeah. Now, let me tell you something. You deny that they're there. You just don't make any sense. Because this scripture right here tells me, I wrestle not against flesh and blood, but these spiritual forces, a hierarchy of demonic powers set on my destruction. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand in the evil day.
Right.
Are we not living in an evil day?
Yes.
I mean, just the dope. Come on, man. 20 years ago, me and my buddy back there, Paul, we've done mountains of dope. And I don't say that bragging, but you do some dope these days and you might die.
That's right.
Just dead. One time, you're done. It's just got worse and worse and worse and worse. And one of the Gospels that described the end of time is like a birth pain. The closer you get to the end of time, the worse the pain's going to be. Stand therefore, having fastened on this belt of truth and having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and as shoes for your feet, having put on the readiness given to the gospel of peace, in all circumstances, take the shield of faith, with you might be able to withstand, might be able to extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one. So, and that's what we want to talk about tonight. What is that shield of faith? You first got to know that you're a spirit being. Then you got to know what is salvation. What does it mean to be saved? We throw that word around. Do we really know what it means? Do you really know what it means to be a child of God? Do you understand how powerful God is? How magnificent? How all-consuming? How that He said, let there be light, and all of a sudden this big ball of gas we got out there that our planet circles around. It rotates and goes around, so we got perfect seasons. He just said it, and it happened. That's your Father. He's your Father. You know, I realized that God wasn't mad at me when my kids will mess up, and I'll get a little perturbed, but they'll come to me, and they'll, especially the girls, will give me a big hug and say, Daddy, I'm sorry. When you mess up, all God wants you to do is crawl up in His lap and say, I'm sorry.
Yes.
It's not that complicated. But what do we want to do? We want to blame everybody else for why we mess up. How many people have done that? You know, when I got called, I wanted to blame everybody. Well, you know, I didn't really do nothing wrong. This is standard operating procedure in the car business. You know, this is just the way we do things. Everybody's always done this. Why are they picking on me? You know what God said? He said, woe is you if you do not preach the gospel. I found that scripture in 2 Corinthians 9:16 says, woe is me if I preach not the gospel. See, I was a preacher. Now, I get to earn my money in the car business, but I'm a preacher. I was born a preacher, and God had a calling on my life. Let me tell you something. The gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. If you're called to something, you've got to walk. If you want, let me tell you something. You can't, it's not, it don't even make sense to turn your back on it, because the real peace, the real happiness, the real fulfillment is when you understand what God created you to do. Let me tell you something. He didn't create you to sit on a pew. He didn't create you to come to church on Sunday mornings and go home and do nothing. God needs soldiers.
Yes.
He needs workers. That's one of the things I admire most about this church is the dedication of the people that go to church here that are willing to roll their sleeves up and work.
Yes.
And take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication. And we're going to stop right there. And there's 6 pieces of armor, but there's 7 things there. And that last thing being the just the most powerful, the one that you cannot get without, and that is prayer. Let me tell you something. You pray. It is impossible to sin if you're praying. Did you know that? You can't go wrong if you're praying. There's no way. If I'm praying and got my mind and my heart and my eyes fixed on God and I'm really praying, I can't mess up.
Right.
I can't go back. So never forget, we got to pray. So what is salvation? Last night I was laying in the bed, 21 days out from the state championships, and I'm just trying to get to bed early, and I got this message going over my mind. I could just see myself preaching, and I just kept saying, God is bigger, God is bigger, God is bigger, God is bigger. I just kept seeing myself preaching that. All of a sudden I heard DJ come in. I went in there and slapped him in the belly and told him he was fat, and he looked at me and he said, I know, I'm mean, but he's mean too. He said some ugly things to me. We joke around a lot. And then he held out a little wristband and said, look what somebody gave me today, a wristband that says God is bigger. So, don't you know God is bigger?
Yes.
Yeah.
See, the issue is the belief in it. See, but if we still see ourselves as that drug addict, that alcoholic, that no good, that insufficient, that messed up, nobody can forgive me. If I still view myself in that old pattern, guess what? God cannot execute his will in your life. God never works independently of a person. Did you know that? See, God always uses somebody. And God uses you to bring joy and to bring life and to bring deliverance to yourself. But if my mind's all messed up and fixed on the things of the world, if my heart is just always thinking evil, if my ears are always listening to sin, if my eyes are always looking at sin, then God is powerless to exact his will in your life.
Amen.
Somebody needs to get that.
Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
It's like a 3-year-old. And you keep telling him, don't touch that, it's hot. Don't touch that, it's hot. And that's us with sin. We know it's hot. We know we're going to get burned. We know we shouldn't be there. We know dope's there. We know they probably got some. They show up at the house. We know it. But what do? Oh, I'm strong. No, you're not. Talk to me in 10 years. You've been clean. Then be strong. Because I'm telling you, you didn't get all messed up overnight. And you're not going to get all unmessed up overnight. Now, God can save you and deliver you and set you free, but that mind has to be renewed. That's the reason we can't just pray for you, deliver you, and put you back out there, because your thinking is still messed up. You do not understand what it means to be saved. So I know who I am. If I know who I am, then nothing can stop me. Because if I know that I am with God and a child of God, I can walk through anything.
Right,
amen.
Right.
Amen.
It reminds me of a story. There's 3 Hebrew children, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And they were questioned. They were told, they said, listen, it's... at this time of the day, you're going to have to kneel down and pray to this king that built an image, a golden whatever statue of himself. He said, you're going to have to kneel down and pray. Don't you know what Satan's telling you? Don't you understand that when you put something in front of God, you are worshiping that thing? Yeah, that's what idolatry's not that complicated. You ain't got to have a little wooden image in your house that you just break incense and kneel down to like some whack job.
Amen.
You just got to have something that takes your time from God.
Amen.
But they said, oh, king, we're not careful to answer you in this matter. In other words, we ain't even had to talk about it. We're not even considering it. It's not even an option for us.
Right.
We will not bow down.
Amen.
They took them. The king got mad. It heated up the furnace. They bound them up. The soldiers that took to throw them in the door, they died. Let me tell you something. When you do God's, when you really follow God's will, let me tell you, He is always with you. They threw them in the fire. Only thing that got burnt up was the ropes holding their hands. And that old King Nebuchadnezzar looked over into that furnace and he said, I don't see three men, but I see four. And the fourth is as the Son of God. God is bigger. He's not going to leave you hanging. I know you got court cases. I know you got DHR. I know you're trying to fight for your kids back. I know you're trying to get free. I know you're trying to put some stuff behind you. And I know you're consumed with fear. Let me tell you something. If you go to prison, prison was the best thing that ever happened to me. And I could say a lot there. So what God is saying in Deuteronomy, He says, I've set before you life and death, blessings and cursings, choose life. Somehow, some of us think that we somehow can wade around there in the middle ground. Right. Not choosing God is choosing Satan. Amen. Period.
Right.
Do you understand what I said?
Right.
All other religions besides Christianity is satanic worship.
Amen.
Period. There's only two ways to worship. God or Satan. Satan wanted to be like God, so he come up with all kind of little clever ways to get worship. Let me tell you what Muhammad is. Muhammad is just a disciple of Satan.
Yeah, that's right.
And Buddha and all the other ones and everything. And every now and then you'll get some like Jim Jones that really goes crazy. So he said, I set before you life and death, blessings and cursings. He says, choose life. If you don't choose life, you have chose death.
Right.
If you don't choose blessings, you have chose to live under a curse.
Amen.
No in between.
Right.
No middle ground.
My Lord.
Like when Elijah took the prophets of Baal up there and hid. Prophesied it wasn't going to rain for 7 years and it didn't. Boy, there's a lot in that story, but we'll just get to the good part. They took him took him up there, and he had this really evil, evil king. And his wife, Jezebel. And they had built all these altars to worship this god, Baal, which Baal was just a higher ranking demon. Everybody, I want you to understand that. When you look at the Greek mythology and Egyptian mythology, and I know I like to watch Marvel comics too, but those were literally demonic entities that were alive at one time, because I read Genesis, the 6th chapter, and it said the sons of God found the daughters of men beautiful, and they lay with them, and they were Nephilim, giants in the land that day, half angel, half man, that was alive on this earth.
Amen.
See, some preachers want to run by. I don't want to run by anything. I need to know all, everything in the Bible so I can consistently bust the devil in his stinking little mouth. I promise I'd jump on him. And I do. Every morning on the way to work, I pray. And I pray. I pray. I pray. Sometimes I get to work and they don't know what's wrong with me. You got a cold? No. I've been praying. The Holy Ghost got me on the way to work. Sometimes in the gym, I got my headphones on. I'm lifting. I'm grunting. Sometimes all the little tongues roll out and they all think I'm crazy. You know what's good about them thinking you're crazy in the gym? They leave you alone. Because some of them just want to talk. I didn't go to talk. I talk for a living. I go to pick up heavy stuff. Rachel realized that she was gaining a little weight. I'm going to pick on her a second. And so she got motivated. She's been getting up at, I get up at like 4:15. She gets up at 4 and sends me a message. Get out of bed, old man. It's time to go to the gym. You're getting fat. Are you lazy? Are you going to lay in bed all day long? She's like 19 messages. So I get to wake up to that every morning. But she's been working out. She's been going hard. She got in there today and started busting on the bag. She was so excited. She come out and her knuckles are bleeding. I'm like, what are you doing? So look, they're bleeding. So there's gloves over there. They don't have to bleed. I said, you know what? Daddy has to tie all this stuff to his hands and pick up the weights like this. And when I bench press, I can't grip the bar because I used to hit stuff with my bare fist. So it all catches up with you. Anyway, well, Elijah, he took those prophets of Baal up there and they built this big altar. And the goal was to call fire down from heaven. If Baal be God, let him show himself. But if God, Jehovah, be God, let him show himself. And they begin to pray and cut themselves. And somebody needs to get that. You know, that whole thing of cutting yourself is just demonic influence in your life. We read about these scriptures. We read about this. We read about that thing about the fiery darts, the fiery extinguishing darts. Well, all that is that's a little demon sitting in your ear telling you to do something. That ain't your thought. If you belong to God, that thought comes from demons. And all you got to say is, I resist you. I plead God's blood that was shed on Calvary's cross. I refuse to listen to that. And you let God's word come out of your mouth. Let me tell you what the devil does. He shakes. He trembles because the weakest Christian on his knees makes Satan scared to death. Amen. When those thoughts come, you have to resist. And I proclaim God's word out of my mouth because there's power of life and death is in the tongue. Amen. And they begin to pray and cut themselves and beg and take off their clothes and dance around. And what Elijah do? He just make fun of them. He said, where's old Baal at? Is he on vacation? Finally, they got through. And then all of a sudden, Elijah said, let me show you something. Start dumping water on that altar. Dump water. Filled up the trenches around it with water.
Right.
And he began to pray, and all of a sudden fire come down from heaven, and it licked up the fire, and it consumed the altar. Amen. And then he took those 450 prophets. I'm going to tell you, prophets were bad back then. He took those 450 prophets of Baal, he took them down by the river, and he cut them into little bitty pieces. He killed every one of them. Now, who is powerful? So you got to make up your mind. Who am I living for? Amen. To not choose God, to not choose blessings, to not choose life is to choose Satan, destruction, hell on earth. Everything's a mess. Drama after drama. Everybody against you. Just all you next thing you're going to know, you're going to be laid up somewhere trying to figure out, how did I get here?
Right.
How did I get here? God is bigger.
Amen.
Now to him who is able to do far more abundantly than all that we can ask or think, according to the power at work within us. And I'm going to read one more scripture as Sarah comes. She's going to sing, and I got to page 2 last week. I have about 36 pages. I got to page 2 this week. We'll just continue, right?
That's right.
Because we're not going to rush God. Everything I said tonight was anointed by the Holy Spirit. Those were not my words. The preacher proclaims the word of God. So let me ask you a question. Was that for someone? You know, I know it was for me a lot of times. And Brother Wayne will tell you this. Boy, we really preach it ourselves a lot. That's just the way it is. But as I read this scripture, get this. He is your heavenly Father. This is out of the Message translation, Matthew 7:7-11. Don't bargain with God. Be direct. We need to pray. Ask God. ask for what you need. And don't understand, I know I don't deserve the life that I have now. I know I don't deserve the wife that I have now. I know I don't deserve the children that are talented and wonderful and love me and support me. I know I don't deserve any of that stuff. But for some reason, beyond my understanding, beyond my comprehension, God has chose to bless me with this stuff. This life. So what I do, I'm not dumb. I've lived under the curse. I'm going to live with the blessing.
Amen.
Yes.
Don't bargain with God. Be direct. Ask for what you need. This isn't cat and mouse hide and seek game we're in.
Right.
If your child asks you for bread, do you trick him with sawdust? If he asks you for a fish, do you scare him with a live snake on his plate? As bad as we are, we know we would not do such a thing. You are at least decent to your own children. So don't you think that God, who conceived you in love, will even be better? Y'all stand with me. Sarah's going to sing, and if you need prayer this morning, I just want you to come up, and I want my people to help me in the altars to be up here with me, and I just want you to listen to the words of this song, because I know some of you struggle with all the problems that you've had in the past and the mistakes that you made and everything else. I just want you to listen to this and understand that you are clean by the blood of the Lamb.
To do, that you can't make.
just want every head bowed, every eye closed, and I just want to ask you now, is there anybody here that doesn't know the Lord as their Lord and Savior? Anybody that needs God? Anybody want to choose life today? Glory, hallelujah. He said he stands at the door and knocks. God knocking on you tonight. There's one that says, I'm tired. You know the thing that I just rolled over in my head? That those years ago, doing the dope and working 80 hours a week, and just, I was always so tired. Always so tired, just wore out. Is there anybody tired tonight? Does anybody got anything coming up? You're sick in your body. You got a court case. You got something with DHR. You got a problem. You got something going on in your life that needs prayer tonight. Anyone?
Shower.
Saved tonight, had several touched, a couple healed. Let's just give God a big hand clap right now as we walk out. Thank you for coming.
Singapore. It's because every time we get into an atmosphere like this, where people will come to church, do whatever it takes to get there. When we get into this moment, there is always a tremendous sense of expectation. Somebody shout expectation. Expectation. So we got this little phrase we've been saying for the last few years. It says the atmosphere of expectation is the breeding ground for miracles. The atmosphere of expectation is the breeding ground for miracles. Only back to an expectation that God is doing something great today. Notice I said he's doing something great. It's not that he's gonna do something great.